Lord, everyone, and good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Come on, we had a whole lot of talking in the sanctuary. We can start praising God now. And we can start praising God at home. This is the day the Lord has made. We come to rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome you to the Fountain of Life Ministries, where our pastor is Elder Juan Hunter Sr. and our First Lady is Minister Melanie Hunter, where Jesus is the fountain and he is the life. We just come in Jesus' name, hallelujah, just to bring joy and hope to your home, hallelujah. And we've come to worship the Lord, so we thank you for joining us this morning in our worship experience. We're going to begin with a devotional reading. And it's going to come out of Romans, the 8th chapter, and we'll begin with the 28th verse. Very familiar passage of scripture, but I believe it is very, very fitting for the saints at this time. We've gone months now without being assembled, and I know some of us might be getting a little low in strength, but the Lord is our strength, and he is our joy, and he is the one, hallelujah, that sustains us. All you got to do is just call the name Jesus, and wherever you are, he will manifest himself. So we're going to read Romans 8 and beginning with the 28th verse. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also predestined it to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's put our hands together and thank God that nothing can separate us. Hallelujah. From the love of Christ. Thank you, Jesus. At this time, as we prepare to go before the Lord in prayer, we are taking prayer requests. As always, I have my phone up here if you need to type in your prayer request. As we begin, we want to definitely continue to pray for our pastor and our First Lady and their family. We want to pray, hallelujah, for all the saints here at Fountain of Life, our deacons, our mothers, our ministers, just all the saints in their respective places. We have Granny Kathy, amen. We want to pray for her, amen. We want to continue to pray for our pastor's mother. We want to continue to pray for Sister Lisa and Sister Gwen and their family, that God continues to be their strength. Amen. We have prayer requests for the youth. Amen. It's summertime. We want to cover our children in prayer. Amen. Amen. That they will make good decisions as they even hang with their friends. The Howard and Doyle family, we want to continue to keep them in prayer as well. I'm going to ask special requests, prayer for my dad, who is still doing good. He's got a little pain in his body, but I thank God for sparing his life from that accident. God is a great God. Hallelujah. We want to continue to pray for, amen, the Ray family in Bowling Green, Kentucky. Amen. We want to continue to pray for our legislature. We want to pray for even our president, all the congressional body. We want to pray for our local body of government, our mayor, our police department, our protesters. Everybody needs prayer. Nobody's exempt from needing prayer. Amen. Kendra Jennings. We want to continue to pray for Sister Kendra Jennings. We also want to continue to lift up our diocesan bishop, Bishop Merritt, and our parent body, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. We want to pray for all of our pastors as they continue to have to make these decisions week by week by week, that God will continue to guide them. Amen. We want to continue to pray for Sister Anna Price. Amen. The Durham family is also asking for prayer. Amen. And all others. And if you haven't been able to put your prayer request in, even at home, you can lift your hands and say, thank you, Lord, for already knowing my thoughts from afar off. Amen. We have Linnell Hollins Amen. We have a prayer request for Sister Linnell Hollins. This is important because we need to know what to pray for. We don't just want to be generalized all the time, but we want to be specific. Amen. Let's pray for the sick and the shut-in. Let's pray for those who are behind the prison wall. Let's pray for those in the hospital, our nursing home, our seniors. Amen. Because they experience loneliness. We want God to be the peace. Amen. We want to pray for our single couples and our married couples. Sister Anna Durham, amen. We want to pray for her and the people of God as a whole. As we prepare to go before the Lord in prayer, we're going to call for Sister Jaquisha Brooks to please come up and lead us to the throne of grace as she, as God leads her. Let us receive her with a hearty praise the Lord.
Father, Lord, we come to you today, oh God, just thanking you, oh God, for all the things you continue to do, oh God. Lord, we thank and praise you, oh God, for the mindset, oh God, to give us, for you to give us, oh God, on coming out on today, oh God, and even the people out watching, oh God. Lord, we thank you, oh God, for just our hearts, oh God, for softening our hearts, oh God, to receive your word, oh God. Lord, we just thank you and praise you, oh God, for how you continue to comfort the people, oh God, the lost loved ones, how you continue, oh God, to be a healer, oh God, to the sick. Lord, we just thank and praise you, oh God, for being a shelter, oh God, to the homeless. You are so good. You are so worthy, oh God. Help us, oh God, just to continue to tap into your presence, oh God, when we feel weak in our spirit, oh God. Lord, we ask you to let your word, oh God, be medicine, oh God, to us, oh God. Lord, we just ask you to just continue to touch, oh God, continue to lead and guide your people, oh God. Lord, we ask you to just give us a mindset, oh God, to grow closer to you, oh God, to just to want more from you, oh God, to just to have a mindset, oh God, to serve you, oh God, with everything that we have. You are so worthy, oh God. You deserve our worship each and every day, oh God. You deserve our praise each and every day, oh God. Give us a mindset, oh God, to do it, oh God. Give us a mindset to keep holding on, oh God. Lord, we ask you to just to remember all of prayer requests that went forth on today, oh God. Lord, you know each and everybody's situation, oh God. So we just thank you in advance, oh God. We come to you thanking you in advance, oh God, for what you're going to do for your people. Lord, we love you. We honor you with everything that we have, Jesus. We ask you just to continue to remember our pastor, oh God. Remember our pastor and first lady, oh God. Continue to give them the mindset, oh God, to continue to serve, oh God. Lord, we just thank you, oh God. Continue to give them the word, oh God, that they can give it back to us, oh God. Lord, we love you and we honor you, oh God, for what you're doing right here in Fountain of Life, oh God. Continue to allow us to grow as a family, oh God, to focus, oh God. Lord, we love you. We give you everything that we need, oh God. We owe it all to you, oh God. Help us to continue to just impress with your presence, oh God. Your presence is so sweet. Hallelujah. So, Lord, we thank you, oh God, for your presence that's in this place, oh God. Lord, we honor you, oh God, and we thank you, oh God. Continue to be with us, Jesus. Continue to be with us, oh God. And we just say yes, oh God, each and every day. We say yes, oh God, to your will, oh God. We say yes to your way, oh God. We honor you, and we just love you in Jesus' name.
We're a little heavy in here. We need God to lift some things. So we're going to take off the spirit of heaviness, and we're going to replace it with the spirit of praise. Just tell somebody at home, come on and bless the Lord with me. Come on and bless the Lord with me. Come on and bless the Lord with me. That's what we've come to do. Come on, let's just put our hands together. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's put our hands together all over the sanctuary in the name of Jesus. We bind everything up like the Lord. Come on, we're going to praise and press through today. Song says this.
Come on and bless the Lord in me.
Hey.
Bless the Lord.
Come on and bless.
I lift you up and I magnify.
somebody, ha. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. As we prepare for the word of God. Hallelujah. Man, shall I live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? How can they hear without a preacher? And how can he preach unless he be sent? Lord, I love you, Jesus. Lord, I
love you.
Our pastor's going to prepare to bring us the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Open up your heart. Open up your spirit. Open up your mind.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
One more time. Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy. I want you to continue to pray
pray for me. I fight sinuses, as many of you know, but kind of struggling with that this morning. So y'all pray with me, with pressure in my head, but it doesn't make a difference. I'm still going to preach the word of God.
Yes, Lord.
But let me, with that being said, and I'm not going to be long, Jordan and Phillip, so y'all just stay right with me. If you would, please, look at the book of Mark in the second chapter. And we'll look at this fifth verse, and we'll look at the 11th verse. And the word of God reads as follows. I'll read in your hearing. The word says, When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, he said, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. And then if you look at the 11th verse, the word of God says, and it says, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy bed and go thy way into thine house. Bless your holy and your wonderful name. We forever need you, even now, that you continue to be with us and sup with us and direct and guide us in a way that's only pleasing to you and not ourselves. We're asking you to render a word unto your people, that they'll hear you in such a way that it will draw you closer, them closer to you. And Lord, that they will be ready when you come. Move any and all obstacles out of the way. Let them hear you clearly, if you would, and do that you're asking them to do. Even your word said, in the day that you hear my voice, to harden not thy heart. You spoke that word to the church. And Lord, we are still listening, and we still are obeying your word. In the blessed name of Jesus, we love you and honor you. In Jesus' name we pray, in the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. I want to look at the fifth verse, if I may, but bear with me. And we look at that fifth verse, the word of God. It says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of palsy, he says, Son, thy sins be forgiven. I like to use the subject, if I may, God addresses the greater issues, the greater needs.
Yes.
And I think it's important for us to look at that and to know that God, he's forever looking at what our greater needs are. And for the most part, we don't always see eye to eye with God to what our needs are and what's best for us. But God always looks at what's best for us. And because of that, we find that God, he takes us various routes and he does various things for us to be able to accommodate our needs. And we look at this particular story, and we find that it is one that many know about, and some do and some don't. But the word of God says in this first verse, it reads as follows. It said, and again he entered, referring to Jesus, said he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. Verse 2 says, and straightway many were gathered together, and so much that there was no room to receive them. So no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them. When we look at the beginning of the story, we find that God, Jesus is making his way, and he has gotten to a place called Capernaum, and as he gets here, the word of God says he goes into a house. And when he enters into this house, the, the Word of God gives tells us about the house and the way that what it accommodated, meaning that it was able to, that the house itself, the capacity of the house, that it was full, and that there was no one else even having the ability to even go in the house because it had met the its capacity, if you would. Well, the word, it gives way to the man with palsy. And the word, it tells us that this particular man had palsy, which was a crippling disease that put him in a, and he had that disease since the time that that he was born, the word of God says. But it says that there were men that had taken him and brought him to this place where Jesus was, as I paraphrase, but they were only faced with a position where they couldn't get in the house because there was too many people within the house, so they didn't have the ability to get in. And so the word of God says that they went as far as to go up on the roof. And y'all bear with me and stay with me. I'm not totally myself this morning, but they went as far as to go on the roof and even to cut a hole within the roof. And as they cut a hole within the roof, they take this man with palsy and they lower him down into the room, if you would. And as they lower him down, the word of God, when you look at it, God, he says here that he honored what they were exhibiting and what they were demonstrating, if you would. For the word is identifying them, demonstrating faith. And this is what we must demonstrate unto God today, that we have faith in God. But one thing I want to make note of, and I want you to look at, because this is very important, that even before they lowered the man with palsy down into the room, the word of God, it describes Jesus being in the room, and as he was in the house, I should say, that while he was in the house, he was doing something. It wasn't saying that he was healing. It wasn't saying that he was singing. He wasn't saying, it wasn't even saying that he was praying. But the word of God said that he was preaching the word of God. And that we can learn that when we have a captured audience, that it's important for the church to remember that when you have this captured audience, for you to seize and take advantage of the audience that God has given you. They did not break out in a hymn, if you would, and they did not break out in an old song, but the word of God says that Jesus, he preached the word of God. And people need to be in a position where they're gathering for more than just singing and more than just eating and doing the things of celebrating and more festive things. But you must know that we should come together to hear the word of God. The word of God, what was before them was the gospel, the good news, if he was. And he was telling them about the good news. Well, when we look at this word, we find that, as I stated, that the man with palsy was lowered, if you would, and then Jesus, he speaks in this manner, and he says, if you would, he says, and they come unto him bringing one sick of palsy, and it says, which was born before, and verse 4 says, for when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was, and when they had broken it up, and they let down the bed wherein the sick, the palsy lay. But Jesus says in this verse, he said, when Jesus saw their faith, He said unto the sick of the poor, he said, son, thy sins be forgiven. And you look at this, if you would, and it's kind of ironic that that they went through all the effort, if you would, to get something from God, but it appeared that what they were asking of God, that they didn't receive it. And we are like that today. We're constantly asking God for this and for that, and things that we think that is good, and things that is better for us. But you got to know without a shadow of a doubt that God will take care of your greater need. And when we look at this word, we find that in God taking care of the greater need, he looked at their faith and how they had demonstrated their faith toward God. And in fact, they had took some extreme measures to demonstrate their faith. The word of God, it doesn't talk about, when you read the story, about anything that they have said. It doesn't talk about them crying out to God or getting a word in from the outside, getting it in to God, telling them what their need was. But the word of God says they went through those extremes to be able to get into the presence of God for him to be able to perform the miracle in which they needed. But no words were expressed at all unto God, if you would, because but what God saw was the extreme measures that they had taken only to get in God's presence. And God wanted me to tell you today that there should be some extreme measures that you are taking to be able to get in God's presence. And because we have become complacent and we have become in a position where we no longer want to be in God's presence. And we find ourselves in a position where even the miracles of God are not being performed within the church. And we ask ourselves the question, where are the miracles within the church? Well, you must know that the miracle still lies in the hands of God, because it still is in God's position and ability to be able to issue that he wants to issue. But one thing, if I may, I want you to see, there was those that was in the house listening to the gospel, if you would, and it was those that was outside, and there was a different mindset in the two. The one that was in the house, and the house was full, and they were listening to the gospel, if you would, but the one that went through the extreme measures, hallelujah, they had something that those that was inside of the house didn't have, and it was faith. Hallelujah. They wanted to see God perform a miracle. So they gave God what he needed and what he wanted for a miracle to be performed. Hallelujah. A word was never even spoken. Hallelujah. But God looks and he looked at their faith. Why? Based on the extreme measures that they took. Based on the extreme measures that they took, because they wanted God to perform a miracle. And we're needing that today, for Jesus to perform miracles in our lives. But there are some things that he is requiring for you to do for him to perform the miracles that you want God to perform. There's some things that you want to do in terms of a sacrifice. You got to go beyond the norm. You're going to have to do some unorthodox things and some things that comes against your flesh and things that nobody else is willing to do.
Yes, that's right.
To get what God has for you to give to you, if you want a miracle, you're going to have to do some things just to move God to receive what God has for you. There were folk up in the house just listening.
Jesus.
And there are folk. I don't have time to preach this thing. I want to preach it. But let me tell you this, if I may. There are folk that are in the house just listening.
Yeah.
They're just listening and will not exercise faith for some change to come about their life. Listen, we're going to have to exercise some faith. I'm not my total self today, but I want you to stay with me if you would. He said, you're going to have to exercise some faith. They never uttered a word, but looking at what they demonstrated was an indication of how much faith they had. See, God looks at what you demonstrate towards him. It's an indication of how much you believe him and the faith that you have towards God. He looked at the faith and Jesus, he said, when he saw the faith and he said unto the sick man that had the palsy, he said, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. And in other words, Jesus, as I stated, he is a God that addresses our needs.
Yes, yes.
So here's what I want you to look at real briefly, if you may, because I'm going to bring this thing to a close. I'm not going to talk long today, but I want you to see this, if you would. Here they bring a man with palsy. They bring him to Jesus and put forth all that external effort to get for a miracle to be performed. But it doesn't appear that God performed the miracle. It's people that come to God and ask God of a number of things. They asking God to do this and to do that, but God turns around and gives them the total opposite of what they asked for. The total opposite of what they asked for. See, God, he does not look at the things we look at. God looks at the greater need that we have. So he turns and he looks at this man who had been in this position all of his life. And because of the love and the compassion and the mercy of God. Look at God. He takes care of the first thing first. Somebody say first thing first. First thing first. First thing first. Don't give me all of that natural stuff. And I need something spiritual that happened in my life. You got to know that God, he said, I got to deal with the spiritual. Somebody say first. I got to look at your spiritual condition first. See, what you don't realize that you're looking at the natural and you're wanting natural things to happen in your life. You want the husband and you want the wife and you want the children and you want the American dream, the home, and you want the fame and the fortune, and the list goes on. But God says, but what I want to do first is I want to deal with your spirit. And I want to help you spiritually. And God, he's starting to put some things in order because it's God that, hallelujah, that had the authority to put things in order. So he says, what I'm going to do, he says, your sins have been forgiven. See, you got to know that it's all about sin. And I told you, don't lose sight on what this thing's about, because I don't care how spiritual you become. I don't care what you ever acquire in God and even in this world. Don't lose sight on what this thing is about. It's about sin.
Yeah.
And the issue of sin. So God said, because of what you all have exhibited by way of faith, he says, your sins are forgiven you. Yes. But look at the scribe. Look at the religious folk. I got to bring this thing to a close. Look at these religious folk. They look at Jesus and they say, look at how can he? Who gives him the authority to be able to forgive sins, if you would? No, nobody has the authority to forgive sins but God.
Yeah.
We look at this word, and there is a dialogue within the mind. And look at God. He's one that he deals with the heart of man. He looks at the thoughts of men. Nobody else has the ability to do that but God.
Yeah.
Look at them, and here they are contemplating in their mind. Look at God. They contemplated all this within their mind about what Jesus could and could not do. Even to the point where Jesus, he looks at them and he confronts them in a way, and he says to them, isn't it easier? What is easier for me to turn and say to the man with the palsy, your sins are forgiven, or for me to heal him? Which one is easier? Look at this. But when we look at this, God, he's showing them something. He's trying to show them that the authority and the power that he has, because they don't truly know who he is. He said, I got to show them who I am, that I am the Son of God, and the power that I have, hallelujah, within me, for them to know who I am. You got to know that even today, even as Israel went to church, hallelujah, they are just like these scribes. They will not believe that Jesus is who he said that he is until it is proven unto them in a physical way that Jesus is who he said that he is. See, Jesus for some is not who he says he is. If I don't live where God, why has God that I told him the address and the zip code that I want to be in? See, Jesus is not who he is, and hallelujah, got the power that he has until, hallelujah, I have this status and reach, hallelujah, this plateau in life, and how people see me, hallelujah, God not who he is, and even answered my prayers until he put me where I want to be. But God, he said, I want to show them who I am. That I want to show them who I am. The scribes will not believe the spiritual, so I got to show them the physical. And that's how some of the folks are today. I don't know who God is, and I won't believe him until you show me the physical. He said, I'll show them. He said, I'll show them. If that be the case, hallelujah, look at the word of God. He said, if you won't believe the spiritual and the authority that I have within the spiritual, let me show you the power I got on this earth. He looks to the man and he says, arise. He said, get up, get up, get up. Hallelujah. He didn't say in the name of Jesus. He didn't have to say it because it was the name that was speaking. He said, rise up and walk. He said, get up, get up, get up. Let me tell you, don't wait for God to do all this stuff for you to believe that God is who he said that he is. And the word of God said he got up. Hallelujah. And he got up and he started to walk. He took his bed and he started to walk. The people, they look. Hallelujah. They said, we ain't never seen nothing like this. We ain't never seen. Come on, let's go, John. We ain't never seen anything like this. But nothing like this. I've never seen it. The word of God said they were in amazement. Why? Because the spirit, the physical, that they saw God do. But let me help somebody here. When God says that he's given you something, you better believe that it's in your possession. You may not see it, but it's in your possession. If God said you got it, and then it's in your possession. If God said I've given it to you, or I've taken it away for you, when he said your sins are forgiven, hallelujah, he put you in a place. Hallelujah, you ain't got nothing to worry about. But here you are saying, Lord, the only way for me to believe, I got to have the physical. Hallelujah. a greater need. And so he dealt with the spiritual. And God has helped you. He's already dealt with your greater need. Let everything just be what it is. Somebody say, I got all I need, 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 I got all I need. God has given me all that I need. I don't need anything else. He's given me everything I need. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. When God has given everything you need, hallelujah, then comes that afterward, then comes the spiritual. If he keeps you here, you're going to have a better life. Then more will come. Get better, and people look at you in amazement and see what God has done for you. They'll look at you and start glorifying God. Hallelujah. You will be like a man with palsy, a big cripple all your life. They saw you, hallelujah, put it to the high, Lord, down. Hallelujah. But God, he needed first. Look at your neighbor and say, do you have what you need? Somebody say, I got it, I got it, I got it, I got it, I got it. See, we get away from this. When you repented of your sins, when you went down in the name of Jesus and filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, God said, I've forgiven you for all of your. He takes care of our greater need. And God blesses us. But the people of God are like these religious scribes. Show me the physical that I'll see your power. I'm here to tell you that the power of God has already, it's already proven itself. He's already shown you. You should already know who he is. That's why you are where you are. That's why you have not, hallelujah, in a position where you have been consumed. Look at God. Look at God. And God has blessed you not to be, hallelujah, for the enemy to have his way with you. Hallelujah. The enemy, he wants to destroy you. But God said, no, I'm going to keep him at bay. I'm going to keep him back away from you. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Look at someone and say, not me, because I got a God, hallelujah, that got all power in heaven and in earth. That's what it is. The showroom said, my power is not just where I came from, but it's also on this earth as well. God will exhibit himself through you and show you the power that he got. You want to say, Lord, have your way. Somebody, show not just the world, but even me and what I believe in you. Hallelujah. That whatever comes my way, I don't have to worry about it. Any weapon that the enemy has brought my way, it shall not. It doesn't have the ability to prosper. Oh, look at God. Look at God. God has never relinquished his power at all. Somebody say, it working. Somebody say, it working. Somebody say, it working. It working. It working in me. Somebody say, I got some power. Power to the book of Acts. Hallelujah. I got power. Oh, bless his holy name. That even when serpents are snakes come to bite me, it will not have an effect. I got power that whatever I speak, it will come into existence. Somebody say power. Power to live right. Power to live holy. Power to be bold in God. Power. Power. Somebody give it a call. The Lord addresses our need.
Thank you, Jesus.
But what you must know that God will deal with the spiritual first.
That's right.
You waiting on all this other stuff to come. I say this. You waiting on what? All this other stuff till what? But he says, I've already blessed you. I gave you what was greater to me than what you need. And that is, somebody say, salvation. Somebody say, I got it. I got sinuses, but I got salvation too. Y'all didn't hear that, did you? In other words, salvation will get me past sinuses. I'm just going to tell you something. I don't know what you're going through right now, but whatever you're going through, salvation will get you through it. Some of you don't hear this message, but I don't care where you are or what's happening in your life. You got to put salvation above it all. God save me. Come on, stand to your feet real quick, man. Even you on your job, say, God save me. Such is a time as this that I can be a witness of the power of God. I parade it in my life. Come on, pray. Hallelujah, God take care of me. I pray a need. He's given us what we needed. When we did this certainly. He's given what we need when we cry out unto God. Come on, say, he heard me. He heard my despairing cry. He heard my despairing cry. Oh, he heard my despairing cry. He heard me. He heard me. He heard me. In the same way he heard me, he'll hear you right now. In the same way he heard me, he says, I want to look low. Oh, look at him. He says, I want to look low. Somebody, I open up their mouth right now. Right now, God said, I got the greater. I got what you need. I don't care what your family is going through or you are going through. God got what you need. Somebody said, I already got it. Well, hold on to it. Hold on to it, harder. Hold on to it. You got to see this thing the way that God sees this thing. See it the way that God sees this thing. The problem is we don't see it the way that God sees it. God says what he's given you is of great value, but you don't see it as great value. You want something else. And sometimes something else is someone else. Sometimes something else is other things, if you would, but God says, hallelujah, this purpose on what's word. Even in the book of Matthew, he says, seek ye. Even in the book of Matthew, he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Look at somebody and say, the rest is going to come. Y'all hear that? Let's say, the rest is going to come. And he said, I'm going to ask. The rest of the stuff and say, you ought to just say, if I get it or not, if I receive it or not, it really doesn't make any difference, because I got the greater. He is the greater. He said, greater is he that is in me. That is in me. Somebody say, he's in me. I don't always feel him, but he's in me. I don't always understand him, but he's in me. Hallelujah. You're the same moment. Hallelujah. And with this man doing that for, how do you know he's doing it? Because it goes up to you. You would have been dead a long time ago. You would have given up a long time ago. Hallelujah. It's God that is with you. Because it's God who is your strength. He given you what you need. You don't need anything else. Stop looking for the physical just for God to exhibit to you who he is, physical or not. I know who he is. Physical or not. Let those physical, and some of us get in great depression because of the physical. Some of us, we get in a low and because of the physical. I know what happened. Lord, I need this. Lord, I want this. The word of God, and you got to hold his word true because it is. He said, I will supply all of your needs according to my riches and glory. Listen, if you got it, it's because God's giving it to you.
Yes, Lord.
If you don't have it, it's not time for you to have it. And if you never get it, then it don't mean you no good. Listen to you, hear that? If you never get it, God said, don't mean you no good. I don't want, I'm not going to bring it to it. I'm going to open up the door. In fact, I'm going to close it. Don't get upset with me. I love you. I'm going to close the door. I got to go. I got to go. I told you I went through it myself. But some people, they got their head down and they complaining and murmuring because God closed the door. He said not. So he took him and took and moved it and taken that out. And you said, I want it. Then he stopped your answer. No, not. That's not for you. I don't want that for you. I don't want that for you. I don't want that for you. I got what I want. Look what's in your possession. Because what's in your possession is what I gave you. If it's not in your possession, that means it doesn't belong with you. When I give it to you, it's because I gave it to you. When it's taken away, now I don't want it with you. Look at God, look at God, look at God. What you got, I gave it. What you don't have, I don't want you to have. What you will receive, it's because God has called for you to have it. I told somebody this a few days ago. Learn to accept what God is doing.
That's right.
See, whether you realize or not, when God's will is going to be done, and it's not about our will but his, then we need to learn to do what? Accept what God is doing. There's many that have lost their loved ones through death. We can't pray. We can't do anything but learn to accept. There's things that are happening within our life, but we got to learn to accept it. It's God that knows what is best. God bless you. Let me encourage one to get what God has ordained for to happen within your life, and that is for you to be saved. And there's only one way for you to be saved, and you got to repent of your sins for the remission of your sins in the name of Jesus. And God said, I will fill you with the gift of the Holy Ghost. There's a birth that must take place. And there is a spiritual birth that must take place. There's a water birth that happens within the, buried in the water that has to take place in our lives. We have to be born of the water and born of the Spirit. The water birth is through baptism. The Spirit is being receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. And don't let folk lie to you and tell you any other kind of way that you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. There's no other examples mentioned in the scripture other than one receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in tongues.
Yes,
folk wonder within themselves why they faced with so many things and don't have any power, because you never did it the way that the scripture says do it.
Yeah.
You're powerless because you accepted what the world says is the way of you getting the Holy Ghost. It's not a chill that runs down your back. It's not a feeling that you have or a thought or any type of emotions or even somebody telling you that you have the Holy Ghost. it plainly states, and there are various scriptures that you find, read the book of Acts.
That's right.
Folk get away from the book of Acts because of what it says in the book of Acts. And they just dance all around it. And when they do hit on it, because they can't help but to talk about it, they don't tell people the truth about it.
That's right.
And God be trying to illuminate people's mind to tell them what the truth is. If you are baptized in his name and filled with the Holy Ghost, you have a plan that God has ordained before the foundations of the world.
Yeah.
And it now works in you. Do you realize that the old patriarchs, the old spiritual fathers, they long to see this day?
That's right.
Where God lives and dwells in the heart of man, and you have it in your possession. It's in an earthen vessel, the scripture says. It lives on the inside of you. You just got to let God direct you. And if you find yourself in a situation where you're doing what you shouldn't do, you don't blame God. Don't blame God, because God directs, God guides. And the Holy Ghost, he comes to lead and guide us in the way of truth. Of truth. God bless you. God bless you. Get somewhere who's preaching and teaching the truth.
Amen.
Get somewhere preaching and teaching the truth. Lord, those under the sound of my voice, bless them. Those that heard your word, bless them. In the name of Jesus, we know, my God, that you're God that gives us all that we need. All that we need. And you give us the greater, which is you. We need forgiveness from you first. In the blessed name of Jesus, before we can even come to you, in the glorious name of Jesus, but you open up a door for us to be able to come before you, the throne of grace boldly, but you had to forgive us in the name of Jesus because of your sacrifice, because of your blood that you've applied, in the blessed name of Jesus, and open up a door where we can call you our Father, where now we can have a relationship with you. In the name of Jesus, we say thank you. In the name of Jesus, we appreciate you. And the life that we live is in gratitude and appreciation unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We wish you Godspeed as you continue to support the church and through mail, through U.S. mail. Our address is 1234 South Florida Street, zip code 42023. 1234 South Florida, 4203. We're here in Louisville, Kentucky. You must know that. And then you can contribute through Zelle, through Cash App, and through our website. So I want you to join in there if you would. And we have the Wednesdays, so no announcements. So we have Wednesday service, which is Wednesday's Word, that's ministered to the people of God through the ministers of Fountain of Life. I want you to tune in then if you would. And that you could be able to hear that all day on Wednesday. And then we have prayer at 7:30, where we have corporate prayer. And we we all have one individual to lead that prayer. And we do that again every Wednesday at 7:30. And then we have another word that comes to you on Fridays at 7:30. And that is on television or it's live streamed as well. God bless you. We appreciate you. Stay tuned in and continue to live for God. It's the best thing that you could ever do. If you got him in you, he's given you the greatest thing he could ever give you. And that is the best that he could give you. That is himself in you. Himself in you. You got the greatest. You got the greatest. God bless you. We wish you Godspeed.